Keep your eyes closed. I want you to pause for a moment. And I want you to feel your body. Become aware of what you live with. Now become aware of your mind. Something you use all the time. Become aware of your intellect, feeling that which decides. Body, mind, intellect. Okay, open your eyes. What is the purpose of your body? What is the purpose of your mind? What is the purpose of your intellect? We've been living with these equipments for years, for decades. What are these here for? What are we doing with these? This is a very important question, which we have this habit of ignoring. And so we continue being who we are, doing what we do, without change. If you can think of development, what is development to you? Financially, politically, socially. When we think of development, in which direction? What degree? Here too, a very important question, which we tend to ignore. And a classic example of that is how a nation is still measuring growth by GDP. The development of a nation is measured by gross domestic product. A few years ago, front page of USA Today, they had a map of America. And in every state, they had a happy face. This is prior to the present election, so obviously. And this article was suggesting that GDP is not an accurate measure of the growth of a nation, of the status of a nation. That they should use HDI, which is the Human Development Index, or the Happiness Development Index. Because shouldn't GDP lead to what people of a nation want? What people of a nation need, rather than an arbitrary number. And they went on to list that the happiest countries in the world are Denmark, the Scandinavian countries. We never hear about Denmark's GDP or Norway's GDP. They're feeling what they need. They're feeling that development. In Denmark, maternity leave or paternity leave is 3 years. Here, I believe it went from 1 year to 6 months. Now I think it's 6 weeks. When we think of our equipments, when we think of development, we often ignore what the purpose of these equipments are, what the purpose of development is. The next 4 evenings, we are not going to ignore this important question. Why? Because we're humans. And what distinguishes a human from any other species is the ability to think. Manava means human. Manava comes from manyate, which means to think. So when I'm thinking, I'm living as a human. When I'm not thinking, then I can't really call myself a human at a deeper sense. Pujaswami Chinmayananda, after he would speak, he would give people a small prasad pustaka, you know, to keep reading, to keep remembering. And one of these books was entitled, in capital letters, Think. That's it. Then part two came out. What was that called? Think again. Because that's the purpose of this equipment. That's what being a human being is. So we are going to think, and we are going to do this using Hanuman Chalisa. Holistic development through Hanuman Chalisa. Holistic for the body, for the mind, for the intellect, for everything that we are. Development. Not just with age, not just with IQ, but in a meaningful way. And there's no better person to do this with than Hanumanji. He knows the purpose of his body, mind, intellect. He's constantly growing. Holistic development through Hanuman Chalisa. I like this word, holistic development, HD. Right? We think of HD in a technology sense. I feel the only way to live in HD, and not just in a technology sense, is to have people like Hanumanji in our lives. How many of you have heard Hanuman Chalisa before, by a show of hands? Have heard it before? Okay. If I asked you how many times you've heard it, it would be in the thousands, correct? How many of you know how to chant Hanuman Chalisa? Okay. So if I ask you to chant the 31st Chopai, you'll be able to do it? Wait, 31? I have to go back to 24. That just started at 1. Like that. We've heard this thousands of times. We've chanted this hundreds of times. How many of you have studied Hanuman Chalisa? Even the people who have their hands up are kind of like, like this. How many of you know Hanuman Chalisa? How many of you live Hanuman Chalisa? Those numbers start becoming more rare. The only reason for Hanuman Chalisa in our lives is to live it. And if we're not living it, then we need to know it. If we're not knowing it, we need to study it. If we're not studying it, we need to chant it. If we're not chanting it, we need to hear it. But finally, it has to be to live it. In Vedanta, a common message is, you have to know the meaning of a subject to benefit by that subject. Imagine me and him both have $1 million. I know it and he doesn't. So I go about my life enjoying, he goes about his life worrying. Yet if we both go to the bank and we ask the manager, value us, he'll say you're both worth the same. You both have $1 million, but he doesn't know it, so he can't benefit by it. And I do know it, so I can benefit by it. Our focus for the next four evenings is not just to hear or to chant, but to study, to know, to live, so that we can benefit by Hanumanji. Who is Hanumanji? He is a superhero, the original superhero. From him came Superman and Batman and She-Ra and all of the other people came from him. And I like to think of Hanumanji as a superhero rather than Superman. If you do a survey amongst who's the greatest comic book hero, I think people will say Batman. In my mind, that's a fact. It's not even an opinion. And the reason for that is that Superman has a gift which you and I don't have. We can't become Superman. He was born like that. Batman, we can become. He simply uses what he has in the most meaningful way. So he's a hero. He's someone that we can become. Hanumanji is the same way. In Ramayana, when Hanumanji is introduced, who is his master? Sugriva. Sugriva is this great, so Hanumanji is this great. He's a servant of Sugriva. But you see, as the text goes on, his master changes. Hanumanji changes too. He goes from a servant to a savior. Now, whenever we're in trouble, we chant Hanuman Chalisa. If we want to prevent trouble, we chant Hanuman Chalisa. He went from a servant to a savior. That's what a hero can do. So we are going to study Hanumanji because he is someone that we also can relate to, we also can become. And Hanumanji is loved by all. Even in Ramayana, still people point fingers at Lord Rama. He sent his wife away to the forest. People point fingers at Mother Sita. Why did she want the deer? Does anyone criticize Hanumanji? None. Now for anyone who's engaged in the world, we're always subject to criticism. Even when you're trying to help someone, they can still criticize you. In those cases of people where you have to ask that person if I can perform CPR on you. Right? What if they say no? What if I break something here and then they puncture an organ of some sort? Criticism, right? You saved my life, but you hurt my chest. But Hanumanji, it's almost surreal that everyone loved Hanumanji then. Even now, we all have an affinity to Hanumanji. If I tell you, tomorrow we're going to shift to Isha Vasya Upanishad, there'll be a few of you and me, you know, that are here. But as soon as we hear Hanumanji, everyone is drawn to him. This is who we are going to study. We're going to know. Who wrote Hanuman Chalisa? Are you sure? Are you really sure? See, if I just ask you that word, then everything all of a sudden changes. Yes, it is Tulsidas Ji who wrote Hanuman Chalisa. So the tradition behind this, he was actually dying. Goswami Tulsidas Ji was dying. And before he died, he wanted to see Lord Rama. He loved Lord Rama. And now just like politics, if I want to meet the president, I have to meet the chief of staff, let's say, or my own governor, or the mayor. To meet Lord Rama, I first have to go through Hanumanji. So as he's dying, he's remembering Hanumanji, and through this came Hanuman Chalisa. And in this writing, he saw Lord Rama, and he was saved. He didn't die. And that's how this tradition has come about. Whenever people are not well, we sit beside them and we chant Hanuman Chalisa, correct? Like a reactive measure. Now we also have the tradition of chanting this before we do anything that's risky. Before you're on a bus or before you have an interview, right? For all of the people who came to Bharat with me on our yatras, every day when we got into our mode of transportation, we would chant Hanuman Chalisa. Who knows what can happen? So Goswami Tulsidas Ji is the writer of Hanuman Chalisa. He's actually an avatar of whom?
Valmiki.
Sant Valmiki. I don't know if you know that. The original Ramayana is written by Sant Valmiki. And Valmiki Ji wrote Ramayana. That's a dharma shastra. He wrote this to teach people about responsibility. He wrote it in Sanskrit, and it's a massive text. Rare is there a person who studied all of Valmiki Ramayana. And when he was finished, he felt incomplete. Now we think of ourselves, when we organize one good party, we feel very, very complete. Or we write an exam, we feel very complete. He wrote Valmiki Ramayana and still felt incomplete. And the reason he felt that is because the focus was dharma and not bhakti. Dharma and not devotion. So he incarnated as Tulsidas Ji and wrote Ramayana again, not from the perspective of dharma, but the perspective of bhakti. Not dharma, but bhakti. So this Tulsidas Ji is not a, you shouldn't think of him as this freelance person. There's a lineage to Tulsidas Ji, Sant Valmiki. Sant Valmiki learned from Narada Muni. Narada Muni learned from Lord Brahma. There's a whole Guru Shishya Parampara right there. It's a message for you and I too. the maturation of our knowledge, the maturation of our responsibilities should be love. If dharma is responsibility and bhakti is love, when we start to love our responsibilities, that's the peak of our evolution. I drive a lot, and so I listen to NPR a lot. And NPR is like one of my gurus. You know, there's many sorts of gurus, so NPR is one of them. And NPR was teaching me that the typical male and typical female have different low points in the week. So for all of the males in the room, what is the low point of the week for you? Every day. Right now. What is the typical low point of the week? Monday morning. Of course, Monday morning. You have to go to work, you have to go to school, you have to run errands, whatever it is. I always like to joke about a man and Monday morning. That he's driving to work, let's say, or he's driving his children to school, and as he's looking at the traffic, as he's looking at the weather, there's a teardrop that trickles down his right eye. And he doesn't want anyone to see, so he quickly brushes it. Oh, it's windy in here, you know? So embarrassed about it. But what's fascinating is that Monday's coming 50 times a year. If you do it for 20 years, that's 1,000 Mondays. Low point of the week for a typical female?
Wednesdays.
Wednesdays, very specific.
I heard that one, yeah.
Friday evening. Okay, now I repeat. NPR said this, not Vivek, okay? Friday evening, because you've tended to what you needed to professionally or errands-wise, and now you have to deal with what's happening at home. He's not going to do it, so you have to do it. Now, what's more intense about this, it doesn't come 50 times a year, it comes 52 times a year. And it doesn't stop after 20 years, it goes for 40, 60, 80 years, correct? And that's why Puja Swami Tejo Mayananda says, work doesn't tire us. It's a lack of love of work that tires us. If you and I learn to love what we do, we never get tired then. So this is shown between dharma and bhakti. Dharma should lead to bhakti. Okay, so we have studied who Hanumanji is, we've studied who Tulsidasji is, and there's another tradition that is known in this environment. Wherever the glories of Lord Rama are sung, Hanumanji is always there. I was saying how we chant Hanuman Chalisa to help people who are not well or to prevent ill health. Physically, mentally, for others. As we proceed with our study over the next 4 evenings, I want you to keep one person in your mind, one person in your heart who's not here. You can know them well, you don't have to know them well, but I want you to offer your experience here for that person. Hanumanji is here. Wherever Rama is, Hanumanji is there as well. So don't feel that this is an abstract subject. This is us communicating with someone who can help. So this is not just for the people in this room, it's for the whole city, it's for the whole state, it's for the whole world. Hanuman Chalisa begins with two dohas. It is preparation for the actual study. We just heard that, you know, if you have to go to the bathroom, go that way. If you have to eat something, you know, eat outside, turn your cell phones on, etc., etc. This is all preparation for the subject. These dohas are there to get us ready for this study. So let's chant these dohas together. As we go about our study, I just want all of you to know, how do you know if this Jnana Yagna has been worthwhile for you? I hope to enable you to share what the message is from each of these chobais. So if someone comes and asks you, what does this chobai mean? I hope that you will be enabled to be able to communicate that to someone else. So we are not going to fly through this. We're only going to study the first 20 chobais this year. Next year, we're going to study the next 20. One of Hanumanji's descriptions is Rama Duta. Duta means ambassador. Lord Rama keeps asking Hanumanji to do his work because anything Hanumanji does or did, he did well. And when someone does something well, you ask them again, you ask them again. Right? So as we study, let us study this well. So we're going to go through the words. We're going to go through the implication. So that we too are reminded and we can help others in their study as well. So let's chant the Doha together.
Shri Guru Charana Sarojara Jara Nija Manu Mukuru Sudhari Varanau Raghuvara Vimala Jasu Jodayaku Bhalachari.
Okay. I'm going to take this in order, okay? Shri Guru. Shri means the one with virtues. That's what makes one a guru. Just because one wears different colored clothes doesn't make one a guru. When Ravana went to kidnap Mother Sita, what was he wearing? He was dressed like a guru. He gave gurus a bad name, starting with Ravana. Ravana is the original bully, which I'll talk to you more about later. When there's virtues, that person becomes a guru. A guru is someone who shows that it's possible to live like a lotus. Shri Guru Charana Saroja. His feet, her feet are like a lotus. Where does a lotus grow? In dirt. We don't see a lotus very often over here. We only hear of a lotus. A lotus grows in dirt, but the lotus is not dirty. The same difference for us. The difference between materials and materialism. In materials, I'm not dirtied by it. In materialism, I'm dirtied by those materials. We just add that M and it's totally different. So a guru is living in the same place that you and I live. In our businesses, in our schools, in our hospitals, in our mandirs. But the guru is above that. The guru is always balance. That's why we worship a guru's feet. The padukas keep the guru balanced. The lotus, the guru is always walking on softness, on comfort. But it's not outside, it's inside. Shri Guru. People who are high maintenance. Everyone knows some high maintenance people. Some people are high maintenance. People who are high maintenance shows there's something missing inside. But when there's fullness inside, then maintenance outside comes down. And that's why I often share with people, if you want to save money, be happy. If you want to lose money, be unhappy. It's the most expensive way to live is to be unhappy. So Shri Guru Charana Saroja, that his feet are like a lotus. And we take the dust of that. And with that dust, what do? Mana. Mukura Sudhari. Mana means my mind, which is like a mirror, I want to clean it. In India, to clean mirrors, what do you use? Often you use newspapers. You use newspapers to clean windows or mirrors. Why? Because it's fibrous. It's rough enough to pull off whatever's on those windows. So we take the dust from the feet of the guru and we clean our mind. And what this means is we want to reflect what the guru is. We want to reflect what the guru is. And if my mind is dirty, I can't reflect that, correct? But if my mind is clean, I can reflect that. Like an actual mirror. So the guru has virtues, I want virtues. So what do? I serve the guru's feet, then I start to invoke those same virtues. Next line says, Varano. Varano means Varana, which means to describe. Raghuvara. Vara means best. Best of the Raghus. Lord Rama is known as Raghukula. He's part of the lineage of Raghu. Now Hanumanji is known as the best of the Raghus, even greater than Lord Rama. How is that possible? When Hanumanji meets Mother Sita, what does he call her? Janani. He calls her mother, not son. He calls her Janani. She replies by saying, Sita. She sees in Hanumanji her own son. Note that she doesn't have children at this point. But she sees Hanumanji as her son. Which shows us that a relationship is beyond biology. A relationship is one of love. So when Mother Sita calls him son, then Lord Rama calls him son. But Mother Sita calls him son first. Another implication to that is that a mother recognizes a child first. So when we say Varana Raghuvara Vimala, the one who has full purity. So I'm about to describe the greatest of the Raghus who is full purity. So if I'm going to think like that, then I'm going to become like that. This is the idea. As you think, so you become. When I say winter storm, okay, two simple English words, what are you thinking of right now? Cleveland. All right? When I say beach, where do you go? Florida, right? Etc., etc., etc. When we think Hanumanji, does negativity come into your mind when you think of Hanumanji? No. So we are describing the greatest of the Raghus. We are describing that which is so pure, again, because I want to be the same. And finally, Jo Dayaku. Dayaku means the one who can give. Pala, sweetness, what we want. Chari, the four things that we want. This is indicating the Purusha comes from the root Purnatva, fullness. Artha means wealth. What is the wealth that is going to make me full? Purushartha, the wealth that will make me full. There's four P's. What is one P I believe will make me full? Pleasure. A greater P than that is possession. Greater than that is position. And the greatest P is peace. Pleasure, possession, position, peace. If you want to be full, here is the way to go about doing it. And Lord Krishna says in chapter 9 of Srimad Bhagavad Gita, whether you're pursuing pleasure or possession or position or peace, the investment is the same. You have to put in the same amount of resources and time and effort. But he said the returns are very different. How long does pleasure last? As soon as it's over, what begins? Pain. How long do possessions last? Isn't it that everything we buy comes with an expiry date of some sort? I found when I had a Nintendo back in the day, that after some years, it just magically stopped working. And I was under the impression that Nintendo has an expiry date on this too, because Super Nintendo all of a sudden came out. Then that stopped working, and Nintendo 64 came out. What about position? How long can you be the president for? 4 years? Maybe 8 years? then nobody even knows who you are. You still get looked after forever, but nobody really knows who you are. What about peace? No one can give you peace, which means no one can take it away from you. Same investment, different returns. Wouldn't you refinance your mortgage if you know you had to pay less here? Or withdraw money from here to invest here if you're going to get a greater return? Hanumanji can give us whatever we want. By this statement being there, really we should ask ourselves, what do we want? So Shri Guru Charana Saroja Raja Nijamana Mukura Sudhari Varanau Raghuvara Vimala Jasu Jo Dayuk Phala Chari. Next. Buddhihina Tanujanike Sumira Upavana Kumara Balapati Vidya Devu Mohi Haramukale Sabikara. When have you heard the word Buddhi before? When someone calls us Buddhu, right? That's when we hear this. Buddhiman, someone with intellect. Buddhu, someone without intellect. So he says, Buddhihina, I am without intellect. Humans are all born with intellects. But if you don't use it, it's like you don't have one then. Use it or lose it, correct? I'm without intellect, which really means I'm ignorant. Why? Tanu. What does tan mean? Body. You know, every day we go upstairs and we say, tan, man, tan, sab kuch tera. And we come back next Sunday, we say it again, tan, man, tan, sab kuch tera, which really means we didn't give it in the first place, correct? Because how can I offer it again? Tanu here means that I think I'm the body. That's what makes me buddhihina. But anyone who has an intellect realizes that they're more than this body. So Janike, Hanumanji, I know I'm ignorant. You know, that's why I'm coming to you. You are buddhiman. I'm buddhihina. Sumido, in the last Doha we chanted Varana. Varana, correct? Varana means describe, Sumido means remember. The word Simran comes from Smarana. Sumido is a version of that. I'm about to remember Bhavana Kumara. When the sun is out, what do you do with your blinds? When the sun is shining, you pull up your blinds, right? And if inside is colder than outside, what do? You open your window. And that wind comes in, and you just feel fresh. The wind is a purifying agent. So Hanumanji, you are the sun of that which purifies, which means you are pure. And you can purify. Purity and purpose go together. Always associate those words, purity and purpose. Why shouldn't you fly into Delhi in December or January? Fog. You can't see, so you can't land. Or you can't see, so you can't take off. Lack of purity. But once the sun comes in and all of that fog goes away, that purity is there, so purpose. You can purposefully land, you can purposefully take off. Bala. What does bala mean? Vidya. But it says vidya here. This is not Hindi. This is Audhi. Audhi Bhasha. Sanskrit becomes Hindi. Hindi becomes Audhi. So it's almost like a village language where letters that are difficult to use become easier. Like, did you know in Sanskrit there's no W? So Saraswati doesn't exist. It's Saraswati with a V. But it's difficult to pronounce, so Saraswati comes out. So here, Vidya. Vidya means knowledge. Sorry, Buddhi. Buddhi means knowledge. Vidya means practicing that knowledge. So Hanumanji, I want V virtues. I want outer strength. I want inner strength. Dehu moi, give these to me. Why? Because if I have virtues, then what happens? Harahu. Harahu means to take away, to steal. In Chinmay Mission, when we greet each other, what do we say?
Hariyo.
So many times when I meet people, then I'll say Hariyom to them. And they'll say, good, I'm good, how are you? And I say, I never asked you how you are. I said, Hariyom. But we're so conditioned to, oh, I'm good, how are you? Hari means thief. Hari means monkey, Hari means lion, Hari means lots of Bhagavan Vishnu. Hari also means thief. And when we say Hariyom, we're calling out to that thief to come and steal from us. What do we want stolen from us? Ignorance. That's what this whole doha is about. And when the ignorance is removed, what remains? Om. Om was there. Om will be there. But as long as there's ignorance, I don't know it, so I can't benefit by it. So we say Hari Om, you know? In our interaction, let us not be ignorant. Let that ignorance be purged so we can feel that Om. So Hanumanji, come and take our Kalesa. Which in Sanskrit we would say, Klesha. What does Klesha mean? Problems, hardships, difficulties, sorrows. Don't we have a whole lot of Kleshas? Today, I heard that our children are Klesha sometimes. Our wife is Klesha sometimes. This Klesha is anything that shakes me. Vikara, it makes me negative. In other words, Hanumanji, you bring in virtues and you push out vices. So these two dohas make us ready for what we're about to study. Actually, you can spend 4 days just studying these two dohas. These two are such a beautiful introduction to the next 40 chopais. So let's chant the first chopai together.
Jai Hanuman Jnana Guna Sagar, Jai Kapi Satihu Loka Ujagar.
Jaya. Jaya indicates priority. We say victory to this person. Victory to that idea. Jaya indicates priority. Jai Hanuman. So Hanumanji, I'll tell you what Hanuman means later. Jnana. Jnana means knowledge. Jnana at a deeper level means that which makes us quiet. And I really like that word because it's different than information. Wikipedia gives me information. So our schooling gives us information. But if something makes us quiet, then that's jnana. It could be the sunset. It could be the snowfall. It could be a child saying something so thoughtfully. We would never say, oh, I got information from that child. But if that child's response makes us quiet, then they've given us jnana. I was about to leave to go back to Niagara Falls, and I was on my laptop just writing some emails, and I had my planner open. I'll just show you in brief how this looks, okay? So it's like hieroglyphic. There's a lot of circles and lines and things that are happening here. So these two boys walk into my room, young boys, okay? And they ask me what I'm doing, so I said I was writing some emails. And then they knew that I was busy. So they're looking at the planners open, okay? And that planner to them looked like Sanskrit, you know? They don't know what Sanskrit means, they don't know what that means, so this must be Sanskrit then. So these two boys are learning chapter 15 of Srimad Bhagavad Gita. This is what we are learning in our Chinmay Mission classes. So the older boy starts chanting Shri Paramatmane Namaha because he thought this was a God book. He thought this was Gita. His brother, who doesn't know how to chant chapter 15 of Gita, he starts going, Hari Om, Hari Om, Hari Om, Hari Om. It was so hilarious and so moving. I couldn't write my emails after that because I was just thinking about these two boys. Jnana, these two boys taught me. They made me more quiet. I know how to read Sanskrit. They don't. But to them, there's such a simplicity. You know, I don't know how to chant this, so I'll just say what I do know, which is Hari Om. Jnana. And the next word is guna. What does guna mean? Guna means virtues. Guna means quality. In this case, guna means acting on that knowledge. You know, there's such a difference between knowing and doing. Pujya Swami Chinmayananda always said, knowing is not doing, doing is doing. We all want to say, I love you to someone, but wanting to say it and actually saying it is totally different. And then meaning it is even more different than that. Hanumanji, I make you a priority because you have knowledge and you live by that knowledge, and not in a small way, sagara. Sagara means ocean-like. In other words, there's no end to you. If you're in the middle of the ocean, you can't see the end. Hanumanji is the same way. There's no end to his virtues. Then, Baranau Raghu, sorry, I'm chanting the Doha again. Jaya Kapisha. Kapisha, Kapi means? Monkey. Isha, the lord of monkeys, the king of monkeys. But if you think, Hanumanji was never the king of monkeys. First it was Sugriva, then it became Vali, then back to Sugriva. So how is it that Tulsidasji is describing Hanumanji as the king of monkeys? Because think, if you highlight Vali first, Vali was the king of monkeys, then what happened to Vali? He was blessed by Lord Rama. His wife got enlightenment and his son got protection. Indefinite protection. Isn't that a much greater position? Being the king of monkeys will come and go, but being tended to by Lord Rama lasts forever. So he helped Vali become greater. And Sugriva actually became the king of monkeys. How? He introduced him to Lord Rama. When Sugriva sees Lord Rama and Lakshmana approaching, he starts running in the other direction. He says, Vali has sent them to kill me. Hanumanji says, wait, find out who they are. So Sugriva says, that's a great idea. You go find out. That's the danger of giving ideas to someone who doesn't work hard. They'll just say, you do it then, right? Your idea, you act on it. So Hanumanji, though he formally was never the king of monkeys, he's the one who made kings. Correct? And it really shows his humility. And at a deeper level, ka means joy. Pi means pibati. Pibati means to drink. The one who's always drinking joy, that person is Kapisha. So Hanumanji is not just a monkey. He's not just someone who makes other monkeys kings. He's one who's always drinking joy. Isn't that the greatest person? Whenever we meet sad people, we just look at them and we keep walking by, right? When we meet happy people, we think, hey, what's wrong with you? Those people confuse us more than the sad people. Because sad people were like that too, but why are you happy? It's so fascinating. Such a person is the greatest, and that's why Dehu Loka Ujaga. In all of the three worlds, you are known. And he's known for his humility. This is one virtue that is so rare in this world, that anyone who is humble, we We just keep thinking about them, speaking about them. In our education system, you always have to be the top person. For a promotion, you always have to undermine another person. Right? We're almost encouraged to be this alpha personality, to be rajasic. Hanumanji doesn't play those games. He lives in a humble way, and that's why he's known in all worlds forever. First verse, more meaningful than when we chanted it. Can you communicate this to someone else now? Pick up on key words. So, jnana makes me quiet. Guna, I live on that. Kapisha, the monkey kingmaker. And Loka, he's known everywhere. Good? We continue.
Rama Duta Atulita Baladama Anjani Putra Bhavana Sutanama.
Rama. Rama means the one whose nature is joy. Duta, the ambassador. If I'm the ambassador of the United States, then I essentially have the same power as my employer. Right? I represent the nation. I have immunity in certain ways. I have diplomatic rights in certain ways. Lord Rama's ambassador naturally will be like Lord Rama. Who reached Lanka first? Hanumanji. When Lakshmana is dying, this is one of the saddest parts of Ramayana, when there's actually lost hope that Lakshmana will not survive. Imagine Lakshmana is the breath of Lord Rama. And who steps in? Hanumanji. I can't find the medicine, so I brought the whole mountain. Sanjeev, now you fast forward a little bit more. Bharata has said, if you don't return in exactly 14 years, I cannot survive. I will end my life on that 14th year plus one day. And Lord Rama also knows Bharata is serious. He can't live without Lord Rama. So, as they're returning to Ayodhya, who comes back first? Hanumanji. He is the greatest ambassador of Bhagavan. Ambassador of joy. Why? Because Atulita, Ati, Ati means the highest bala, strength. He's the dhamma of strength. In other words, this type of strength is not just outside, but it's also inside. I was traveling through the Chicago area for the last little while, and I was doing a lot of workshops with youth, and I always share with them a story about carrots and eggs and beans. When you put a carrot into boiling water, it goes in hard and comes out soft. You put an egg into boiling water, it goes in soft, comes out hard. You put a coffee bean, I didn't just mean beans, I meant coffee beans. Coffee beans into water, they go in fragrant, and then they make everything else fragrant too. Some of us are like carrots, you know, strong outside, but when pressure comes, we become all weak. Some of us are very soft inside, and when pressure comes, we become bitter, cynical, negative. Some of us are cheerful, and when there's pressure, we make everyone else cheerful too. Hanumanji's bala is not just outside, his bala is inside. Mahatma Gandhi, when he came into the British Council to meet them, he would go with his dhoti, angavastra, that's it. And people used to stand for him. They used to call him Mahatma, Mahatma, Mahatma Gandhi, Gandhi. Why? His name is Mohandas or Karmachand. But they too called him Mahatma because not outer strength, but inner strength. Hanumanji's mother's name is Anjana or Anjani, which is why Hanumanji is known as Anjane. Anjana means the one who is most pure. And this purity is not external, this purity is in her intellect. Finally, the ego lives in the intellect. So Anjana means the one who has a pure intellect, which means that she's past that ego. And Hanumanji's father is Pavana. Pavaka means that which purifies. So Hanumanji's mother is so pure. Father is so pure. When you combine pure and pure, you get purer then. Hanumanji's that pure, and that's why anywhere he goes, purity. How do you know if you're becoming more pure in mind? Vijaswami Tejamananda shares, the softest pillow is a clean conscience. The softest pillow is a clean conscience. When I live rightly, when I act rightly, then what happens is I go to sleep well too. But if I hurt you verbally, physically, whatever it may be, then when it comes to nighttime, what am I doing? Thinking about, why did I do that? Why did I share that? Fearlessness. How do you know you're becoming more pure? You're less afraid. Dirt, mala, is fear. And vimala is then fearlessness. So you are the ambassador of Bhagavan Rama. Because of your outer strength, because of your inner strength is your purity. 3. Mahabira Vikrama Bajarangi Kumati Nihara Sumati Ke Sangi. Mahavira. This is a very beautiful word. Vira means greatness. There's 5 types of viratva. 5 types of greatness, which I think you should know. The lowest type of vira is called rana vira. Rana means battle. To be great in battle, it's great, but it's really the lowest type of greatness. More evolved than that is not rana vira, but dharma vira. Dharma means responsibility. To be great in your responsibilities, that's more involved. So in battle, in our fights, responsibilities greater than that is dhanavira. To be great when it comes to generosity. To be great when it comes to giving. Even more involved than that is Vidyavira, to be great when it comes to knowledge. My younger sister is a chartered accountant. And when she and I chat, I ask her about where her clients are, what she's doing, and so on. And one day I asked her, how much do you bill your clients? And she said, $300 an hour. I was shocked. I said, who thinks you're worth $300 an hour? But she has a knowledge that the client doesn't have, so she's worth that $300. Now that's still an objective knowledge. Imagine having a subjective knowledge. Imagine you had a knowledge that can make you happy forever. We always see that in fairy tales, right? They lived happily ever after. A kiss, happily ever after. A marriage, happily ever after. A kingdom, happily ever after. And then they should close it. They close a movie, right? Because they actually don't live happily ever after. They just don't want us to know that. I had heard a really thoughtful proverb. If you want to be happy, and I've shared this with all of you many times, if you want to be happy for an hour, what should you do? Take a nap, right? Even now, what better way to spend an hour in sleep? If you want to be happy for a day, play a sport. know, go to see the Cavs play, or go tobogganing, or attend some sort of dance workshop. If you want to be happy for a month, what should you do? Get married. This is an old Chinese proverb, okay? So think a honeymoon, right? The moon waxes and the moon wanes, and then Amavasya. Amavasya stays. No moon continues. If you want to be happy for a year, what should you do?
Win the lottery.
Inherit a fortune. In Ontario, they studied people's financial stability before and after winning a lottery, and they consistently found that a year after winning a lottery, people were less financially stable. It's amazing how true this proverb is. If you want to be happy for a lifetime, what should you do? Help others. If you want to be happy for a lifetime, you should help others. See how the degree of joy is increasing. But we're all Vedantic students. We know we don't just live for one lifetime. Correct? If I'm happy for this lifetime, that doesn't guarantee what will happen in the next lifetime. That's why Pujaswami Tejramayana says, if you want to be happy forever, know thyself. If you want to be happy, happily forever, you know, to live happily ever after, you have to know what your nature is. Helping others is not enough. That vidya vida is necessary. What was at the lowest level? Then? Then? Next? I can read as well. You should look at me and answer these questions. And the highest is? Daya vida. Daya means compassion. Daya means gentleness. The greatest sense of greatness is being compassionate, empathetic. It's harder, isn't it? Being great in a fight, you know, lots of people can be that. But to be great in not fighting, that's rare. If you have all five of these greatnesses, then you can be called Mahavira. So that word Mahavira is not to be taken lightly. It's much bigger than that. And actually, I'm going to take it to one level even higher. After Mahavira is Vikrama. Vikrama means the one with no limits. When these five types of viratva, this greatness, is directed towards the higher, it's called Paramavira. So more than Mahavira is Paramavira. Then one has no limits. One is infinite. So Hanumanji, you are Mahavira. In fact, you're greater than that. You are Vikrama. And then he brings in a very awesome word, Bajrangi. Right? There was a movie that recently came out, Bajrangi. And we say, Bajrangbali Jai. It's actually Angi. Angi's body or limbs. And it's not Bajra, it's Vajra. You know, after you eat, you should sit in Vajrasana for 20 minutes to digest your food. It's Vajra Angi. I'll tell you a story related to this. Back in the day, the Asuras and Devatas were fighting. And I really shouldn't say back in the day, they're always fighting. Our scriptures are all based around these Asuras and Devatas fighting. Devata is someone who has light in their heart. Asura is someone who doesn't have light in their heart. So that's actually you and I. When we are selfless, devatas are winning. When we are selfish, asuras are winning. So one time, the asuras were defeating the devatas big time. They were nearly crushed. And the devatas didn't know what to do. So they sought the help of Rishi Dadichi. He's this great being. Rishi means someone who can see. Not with their eyes, but with their mind. They see more than we can see. And they went to Rishi Dadichi and said, we are not winning. We are going to lose forever. We need your help. And Rishi Dadichi says, use me. What do you mean, use me? You take my bones and you make a weapon that the asuras cannot defend against. So he gave up his very bones, and from that was made the Vajra. The thunderbolt that Indra has is made of Rishi Dadichi's bones. And it's shared, anyone who is hit with that Vajra is destroyed instantly. Now the deeper implication to this. I always want us to know the story and to know the meaning as well. That for someone who is a Rishi, their strength is right down to their nature. You know, if you say, love is in my bones, you know, that saying, or soccer is in my bones, that means it's my nature. It's who I am. A great person is not just great with other great people. A great person is great even with not so great people. You know, we're all very sattvic around each other. But how are we when no one is looking? How are we in our own rooms? That's different, right? That whole idea of closet personality comes out. When no one's watching, how much do you eat then? When people are watching, right? Very strict about eating. Look how little I took. But then as I'm putting my plate away, I'm eating, you know, secretly. And then you have to chew fast, that way no one sees you. But then it doesn't even taste good. This is what I've heard people do. I'm not that person. Not that person. So, Hanumanji is known to have a body that is Vajra Angi. And I'll tell you this tomorrow. Hanuman. Hanu means chin. Man means someone who has a chin. So really, everyone in this room is also Hanuman. So this is your biography that's being chanted. We are all not Hanumanji, okay? That J-I separates us from him. He actually got hit by the thunderbolt. I'll actually tell you that on Sunday. It's one of the most important messages. When he got hit by Indra's thunderbolt, he did not get destroyed. All that happened is he became unconscious. And when he hit the ground, he broke his chin. That's why he's a big cleft. I think it's called a cleft there. And his mouth is swollen, right? Like that. So that's why his body is known as Vajrangi, because he never got destroyed by the Vajra. And now my last thought for this evening. Kumati Nivara. Mati means minded. Ku, whenever you hear that K-U in front, it means bad-minded, wicked-minded. Then you have another mati, and what's in front of that? Su. Su means good-minded, noble. Kumati Nivara, the one who makes me free from bad-minded people and bad-minded person. N.K. Sangi, the one who brings me good-minded people, the one who makes me good-minded. In other words, this last line is simply talking about satsang. Satsang is the most obvious secret, I think, that anyone can engage in to become better. What is the challenge of working out at home versus working out in a gym? At home, you're the only one. There's more beds in your home than people, correct? There's two fridges, one in the garage, one in the kitchen, or one in the kitchen, one in the basement, filled with food. But at the gym, there's no beds. There's no fridges. And there's other people. You know, when someone's using a treadmill, someone's lifting a weight, someone's pouring water on themselves, you know, something that's happening. So I also feel like I should do the same. In satsang, we invoke the presence of people. And we overestimate how strong we are, thinking that people don't affect us. They certainly do. Don't we tell our kids, don't give in to peer pressure? When I meet kids, I say, when your parents tell you that, you tell them that. Don't give in to peer pressure. And actually, it's not don't give in to peer pressure, don't give in to negative peer pressure. You should give in to positive peer pressure, no? Satsangatve nissangatva. Adi Shankaracharya says, the first step to independence is satsang. It's so obvious, but still we make it a secret, you know? So, what are you all doing on Thursday evening? Oh, we're going to the mandir. What's happening there? Just some people are getting together. Right? It's satsang. That's what you're doing. We're exposing ourselves to Hanumanji, to the Guru Shishya Parampara. We are affected by people. When you see someone crying, don't you have a greater inclination to cry when someone's being very emotional? Or when someone's angry at you, don't you become more angry? Or when someone's smiling, then you can't help but smile too. Physically, we're affected by people. Hanumanji, he changes our friend circle. So if you don't like your friends, study Hanuman Chalisa. And if you want different friends, Hanuman Chalisa. A lady I used to work with, I went to visit her, and she said, so what are you doing now? So I was telling her about traveling and teaching and all of that. This, you know, smaller, older lady. And as I'm describing this, she looks up at me and says, no time to get into any trouble. And I thought that was such a great observation, that if I'm engaged in satsang all the time, then I can't be part of dussangha. I can't be in negative company. So in Chopai 1, we studied how it's not enough just to have information, but we have to become quiet and we have to live that. Then we become happy and we become humble. In Chopai 2, when we do the Lord's work, we invoke outer strength and inner strength. And that inner strength is in the form of purity. And purity is expressed as fearlessness. And in Chopai 3, we studied the different types of greatness. That we should be holistic, right? Not just in Rana, not just in Daya, but in everything. And we should direct this higher. Then Vikrama, no limits to my happiness. And when I do this, I become good-minded, and I can radiate the same to others. Now, whenever I see this word, Kumati and Sumati, I must tell you a story related to this. A few years ago, we had a World Workers Conference at Chinmay Vibhuti. It's our ashram in Pune. And at that time, I was asked to be the MC. One of my batchmates and I were the MC. So we were introducing people that were about to speak. And I'm introducing this girl, and I say, Srimati so-and-so. And then she came, she spoke. After that, there was a pause, so I was sitting in the green room with Pujaswami Tejramayana. We were both there. And he said, you can't call her Srimati because she's not married. Srimati implies someone who's married. It actually doesn't. Srimati means someone who has virtues. So now we've made it as someone who's married. If I'm married, I must have virtues. It shows that marriage can bring about those virtues. You see, these words are so meaningful. I hope you also feel the same way. Otherwise, we just keep saying Srimati, 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 Sriman, Sriman, Sriman. Sriman means someone who has Sri. Sri is virtues. Just because I'm a male and I'm married, I shouldn't call myself Sriman. I'm the president of my home, so I put it on my business card, president. So he told me that she's not married, so you can't call her Srimati. And then the time ran out, so we had to go back. And like newspapers make mistakes, so they put that, you know, yesterday's edition was wrong. So I told everyone, I said, you know, I made a mistake that I called her Srimati, whatever it is, but she's not married. But I didn't know what to call her. But I don't know these designations. I know Mr., Mrs., etc., etc. If she's not Srimati, what is she? And Swami Tejamananda felt my plea. So he saw me struggling. So he yells out, Kumari. Kumari means someone who's a youth, someone who's young. And by accident, I said out loud, I said good, because I was about to call her Kumati. Opposite of Srimati, Kumati, right? Which would have been, she's a wicked person. So satsang. As we go about studying these 20 chopais this year, I want you to think of one word that will help us to remember that chopai. So now when you think of chopai one, maybe it's quietude, maybe it's joy. But I want you to, your own reflection, to associate that chopai with one word. Okay? Then I want you to associate one practice with each chopai. So every time you hear chopai 1, every time you read chopai 1, you'll know this is what I have to practice. So as an example, in number 3, okay, number 3 is about, the word is satsang, let's say. And the practice is, I shouldn't speak negatively. Just an idea. Because we have to remember to be able to practice. I really am trying to emphasize that during this Jnanayagna. It's not about hearing, it's not about chanting. It's about knowing, it's about practicing. And the best time is now. In simple Audi, simple English. There's another Chinese proverb. When is the best time to plant a tree? 20 years ago. You're all saying yesterday. 20 years ago. When we were 5, we should have started knowing Hanuman Chalisa. Notice how I said 20, I will compliment it all of you. The next best time?
No.
Keep that in mind.